In this video, we will discuss memory management. So the processor is the most important resource, but it cannot work in isolation. So memory is the next most important resource, and there is a constant interaction, that is a communication between memory and the processor. So there are different types of memory in a system. Semiconductor memory is the primary memory or main memory. There is also a second memory, which is your hard disk. The function of an operating system with respect to memory management can be listed. Okay, the first one is all programs are run with the code on the data in the RAM. So for a program, RAM space has to be allocated when the program runs and deallocated when the program terminates. The operating system has to keep the track of the RAM space when this is being done. Then secondary memory is byte, that is a secondary memory is a large storage space. The operating system is expected to keep track of this storage space and allocate it adaptly, that is a user requirement. The most important aspect of a memory management is the virtual memory concept. So the primary memory and secondary memory together constitute a system of a virtual memory, which is a game played by the operating system to get the user into believing that has unlimited memory space. So this needs a little more explanation. So virtual memory is a concept by which the application is made to believe that it has a much more memory than physically available memory. In effect, there is an idea of an enlarged address space, which is called as a virtual address space. This space maps into a physical address space utility. Semiconductor memory, which is a reasonably fast, that is a RAM type and ROM type, that is usually designated as a primary memory, main memory or physical memory. Then the hard disk and other memory types are designated as a secondary memory. Okay. Then the processor directly communicates with the main memory only, but data movement between the secondary and the main memory is possible. Okay, then whenever an application is to be run, the processor expects to find the associated data and code in the main memory. In case it is not found there, it should be brought there to from the hard disk. So this takes a small amount of time. This is the reason for computer slow if the RAM size is low. However, even if the RAM is of a larger capacity, it is not necessary that our application files are currently present there. Then managing the system such that important data and code are found in the main memory most of the time is part of the cleverness of the operating system. Nowadays, in most computers, there is an additional level in memory hierarchy, and that is the cache, which is the fast SRAM memory, static RAM memory, and which contains a copy of some parts of the RAM content. Then memory management in an embedded system. In an embedded system, the kind of memory available are RAM and ROM type memory. Technologically, there are different kinds of RAM and ROM, like RAM may be SRAM or SDRAM. Similarly, ROM may be flash memory and EEPROM memory or EEPROM, like that. So the memory management involved in an embedded system is less complex than in general purpose personal computer, but there are some aspects to be managed. When the system becomes a complex and dynamic, memory allocation technique may become necessary. Okay, but application program for simple embedded system almost always use a static memory allocation. In such cases, there is no need for a special technique of memory management. So this is about a memory management technique. Then the next slide shows a timer and a counter devices. Counter and timer devices provide a variety of measurement solution, including measuring a number of real-time related quantities. For example, it is used for frequency management, then it is used for edge or even counting, then it is used for pulse width measurement, then used for event time stamp, then used for pulse width modulation, etc. Timing device or timer, that is it is a device that count the regular interval clock pulses at its input. That is the function of a timer circuit. The count are stored and incremented on each pulses. So it has the output bit for the period of count. All microcontroller units have timers as one of its peripheral devices. A timer is a dedicated hardware for timing event to generate waveform and so on. Once a timer is started, the CPU does not have an interface, as the timer hardware will take care of it. So a number of registers may be associated with the timers, but basically there is a timer count register and mode register to decide between different operations, different options or operations. So the method of working of timer is that the processor clock acts as the reference clock, and in many cases this clock frequency is divided by a constant to get a lower frequency clock. In the timer count register, a number is allocated and timer is then started. The count keeps increasing until it reaches the maximum value, or the count keeps decreasing until it reaches the minimum value. At this point, the count register reset to zero, and this is indicated by a flag bit or interrupt register. Okay, then the time elapsed between the starting of the counting and resetting of the count register can be used as a measure of the time delay. In many microcontrollers, there is a prescaler that reduces the clock frequency used as the reference, so that a longer time delay is obtained. The range of prescaling is required can be indicated in a prescaler register. Similarly, counting device or counter. A counter or counting device is a device that counts the input for event that may occur at irregular or regular intervals. The counter gives the number of input event or pulse since it was a last read. In timing application, the reference clock is taken from the processor clock, but there is another duty for timer unit or to act as a counter. A counter counts external events, such as it does not use the processor clock. For example, if the frequency of an external square wave is to be measured, the square wave is given as an input to a specific microcontroller pin and the timer is started. The number in the count register gets incremented for every edge of the incoming square wave. And doing this for say 1 second gives us the number of edges counted during that time. So in this way, the frequency of the incoming square wave is counted. When the timing unit is used in this manner, it is called as an event counter. For more sophisticated microcontroller, there are advanced compare and capture unit which perform counting in a very systematic manner. Okay, it is necessary to know the details of individual microcontrollers for understanding it completely. The next slide is a watchdog timer. Watchdog timer is an additional timer that does a monitoring job and reset the system if necessary. Most embedded systems are expected to be self-reliant. This is very little possible of an intervention by a human operator in case the associated software goes away by getting stuck in an infinite loop. Some embedded systems are placed in accessible sites like factory environment, space probe, etc. When the software is detected to be malfunctioning, the best way is to reset and start again. Such anomalies can occur due to various reasons like deadlock, noise, voltage on some pin, which may cause a wrong triggering and so on. So if such a situation arises, there should be a mechanism by which there is automatically detected and gets the system to reset. So the watchdog timer is likely any other timer, and it can be loaded with a count which decrement down to zero. When it reaches zero, it resets the processor. For a system which is doing its job correctly, the watchdog timer will never count down to zero. Before that, the correct operating software will restart it periodically and reload its original count so as to prevent it from counting down to zero. The number loaded as the count in your watchdog timer is decided by considering how much time is to be allowed for the system to recover before it to be forcibly reset. So this is the case when watchdog timer is external to the processor. So 8051 microcontroller do not have an internal watchdog timer, but most of the microcontroller families like PIC controller, AVR controller, ARM controller, etc. have it as an internal timer circuit. So when the processor gets reset by the watchdog timer, it is called a soft reset or a warm boot. So this is about a watchdog timer. Then the slide shows the real-time clock. Real-time clock means the information can be read by the microprocessor usually over a serial interface to facilitate the software performing the function that are time dependent. So RTC are designed for ultra low power consumption, as they are usually continue running when the main system is powered down. So this enables them to maintain current time against an absolute time reference usually set by the microprocessor directly. So this is the diagram. So real-time clock maintain its a clock by counting the cycle of an oscillator, usually external oscillator circuit. It is operated at 32 kilohertz. Like that, crystal oscillator circuit may be used. The next one is the emulator circuit. So emulator means it is a piece of hardware that ideally behave exactly like the real microcontroller chip with all its integrated functionality. So it is the most powerful debugging tool of all. A microcontroller functions are emulated in real time and non-intrusively. So that is called emulator. Okay. Then the next slide shows the in-circuit emulator circuit. So in-circuit emulator is a debugging tool that allows you to access a target microcontroller for in-depth debugging circuit. So a genuine in-circuit emulator requires you to remove the microcontroller and to insert in-circuit emulator in its place, most commonly using an adapter. In-circuit emulation is rather rare in these days of high performance, relatively low cost processor, because ICE needs to be invisible to the system, which is difficult to do with extremely fast memory intensive chips. Not every system requires a high performance microcontroller, and it's still possible to use ICE. ICE is nothing but an in-circuit emulator circuit. So ICE is the best tool for finding difficult bugs and can provide invaluable insight. So this is about in-circuit emulator. Then next one is a target hardware debugging circuit. So here first one is a monitor. So monitor is a debugging tool for actual target microprocessor or microcontroller in ICE, ROM emulator, or in target development board. It also it's a host the system debugging interface just like an in circuit emulator. Then monitor from different sources differ in their functioning. One typical monitor does the following. The first one is a monitor load the application codes is also used for a correction in code and then to test the system. A command for a download can download a new application code into the monitor. A command for resetting the program, restart the program monitor, load the application from the developing system can also be modified later to correct the codes. Then after that, a part of the monitor runs on a host system. Debug monitor codes are downloaded along with the locator binary images. A write and a read command is used to correct or examine the code at the memory address of the system. Then monitors control the execution of application at full speed as well as by single stepping during the debug operation. Then monitor control the breakup point as per command from the debugger. A breakup pointer or partition the program into separate segment. When a program segment runs, there is a pause at a break point and the test result is observed. After the run and it is examined, then the segment is run. Breakpoint enables a program test running between the different program segments. Then after that, monitor can be run in a single step mode also. Then monitor facilitate controlled execution of application and controlled display of executing program status. Then monitor means a ROM resident program at the target board or ROM emulator connected to ICE. Then it monitor the device applications. It runs for different hardware architecture and it is used for debugging. So this is about a target hardware debugging. So in this video, we have discussed about memory management, timer, counter devices, workshop timer, real-time clock, emulator, in-circuit emulator, and target hardware debugging circuits. Thank you.